Good evening, viewers of Akshi by Vithi from Pondicherry. Today, I am going to discuss another important concept, the laws of chemical combination. This is the most important unit under the basic chemistry. Laws of chemical combination, you might have studied already in your 10th. So let me discuss today. Generally, a compound is formed by chemical combination of two or more different elements obeying certain basic laws called laws of chemical combination. That is, whenever a compound is formed by chemical combination of two or more different elements, you should obey the laws of chemical combination. Actually, there are totally five laws of chemical combination we are going to see. The first four laws correspond to the chemical combination by weight. That is the most important information I want to record here. First four laws correspond to the chemical combination by weight, and the last one, fifth law, corresponds to chemical combination by volume. So let me explain one by one with suitable examples. So this is the most important because competitively questions are asked under this. So let me go for the next. What are the five laws? Here I have given the five laws with the corresponding author proposed. The first law, law of conservation of mass, was introduced by A. L. Lavoisier in the year 1785. A. L. Lavoisier introduced the law of conservation of mass. The second law, law of definite proportions or law of constant composition, it was proposed by J. L. Brost the year 1799. The third law, law of multiple proportions, was proposed by John Dalton, the famous author, the famous scientist, in the year 1808. John Dalton only introduced the term atom. The fourth law, the law of reciprocal proportions or law of chemical equivalence, introduced by J. B. E. Richter in the year 1792. Finally, the law of gaseous volumes or law of combining volumes, introduced by Gay-Lussac in the year 1808. So kindly, here I want to give one information. Kindly look, why I am giving here? This is for, to give information for the students. When you are studying atom, molecule, mole concept, the next concept, and we will come to know that atom, the atom was introduced, this term was introduced by Dalton in 1808. That is the most important thing. 1808 only he introduced atom. But before knowing what is atom, actually all the five laws were proposed. This is the most important information I want to record here. So all these laws were introduced before 1808. Okay, let me go one by one. Law with a suitable example. First one, a law of conservation of mass. Law of conservation of mass. The exact statement given in the 9th book of CBSE, this is the statement given. That is, mass can neither be created nor destroyed. Mass can neither be created nor destroyed, but can only be redistributed in a chemical reaction. That is, in a chemical reaction, mass will not be created newly and mass will not be destroyed completely or partially. So that is the law of concentrated mass. So in order to understand that is given in a chemical reaction, that is most important. In a chemical reaction. Okay. In a chemical reaction or chemical change. What is a chemical reaction? A chemical reaction is one where one or more reactants react to produce one or more products. So here I have given two examples. In the first case, formation of water is indicated. I have given formation of water, I have shown here. That is, hydrogen combines with oxygen to produce water. Here two reactants combine to produce the water product, one product. Okay. Whereas, in the case of second example, calcium carbonate, decomposition of calcium carbonate example I have given here. So, only one reactant, but products are two. One is calcium oxide, one product, carbon dioxide, another product. That means here one reactant on decomposition give two products, calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. So calcium carbonate compound, calcium oxide compound, CO2 carbon dioxide is also compound. So in this chemical reaction, one or more reactant react to produce one or more products. So let me explain further the law of conservation of mass. The other form of law of conservation of mass is, in a chemical change, the total mass of the reacting substances is equal to the sum of the total mass of the product. That is the most important thing. The total mass of the reacting substances in a chemical change is equal to the sum of the total mass of the all the products. That means when we are starting any chemical reaction or change, initially whatever mass is present, final also the same mass should be, the total mass should not change. That is the fundamental law of conservation of mass. So in order to explain, here I have given an example, formation of carbon dioxide. So carbon reacts with oxygen to produce carbon dioxide. Carbon, you know, is solid, oxygen gas, and then both are elements. Then CO2 compound, it is formed. So in terms of mass, so I can now explain you. 12 grams of carbon, left side, combines with 32 grams of oxygen to produce 44 grams of carbon dioxide. So just left side, you can simply add 12 plus 32, nothing but 44. That means total mass of the reacting substances, that is left side, 44, is equal to right side again, 44. So this is obeying law of conservation of mass. So you can take any example, the formation of any compound, you can calculate like this, you can understand that always the law of conservation of mass is obeyed. That is, the total mass of the reacting substances is equal to the sum of the total masses of all the products. This is the most important law of conservation of mass. I hope you have a clear idea. Let me go for the next law. The second law. Law of definite proportions or law of constant composition. That is, we are giving like this, law of definite proportion, or the same law, another way, we call it as law of constant composition. Okay, what is the statement? Two ways the statements are given. One is, in a chemical substance, you know already, substance means it may be element or compound. In a chemical substance, the elements are always present in a definite proportion with mass. So if you take any element, say for example a compound, the elements always present in a definite proportion by mass. This is one form of statement. Another form, the same compound, by whatever method it is prepared, always contains the same elements. Combined together in the same fixed proportion by weight. This is the most important law of reciprocal proportion, the law of constant composition. Let me repeat again. the same compound by whatever method it is prepared always contains the same elements combined together in the same fixed proportion by weight. So let me explain with the suitable example. So law of constant composition. In a compound such as water, say for example, let us take now water, specific example. The ratio of mass of hydrogen to the mass of oxygen is always 1:8, whatever the source of water. So take water, the formula we know, it is H2O. Here it is formation of water shown. So here in this case, the ratio of mass of hydrogen to the mass of oxygen, that is normally in the form of 2 grams of hydrogen and 16 grams of oxygen. So in the ratio will be 2:16 in terms of mass, or 1:8. That is, here it is given always in the ratio. So this is the law of constant composition. And the composition will be always constant in any compound. Okay. Other way, second form. Let me explain. The second form, we have already discussed. Whatever method we are preparing a compound should have the same elements, same composition, the same definite proportion it should be. So here in this case, a specific example I have taken, copper oxide compound. So copper oxide can be prepared by two methods. One is multi-composition of the copper nitrate, I can get copper oxide. By decomposition of copper carbonate also, I can get copper oxide. By both methods, I can prepare copper oxide. So there are two different methods here I have prepared. So whatever method I have prepared, the compound formed is only CuO. That is the most important. Okay, in this compound, so definite proportion. What is definite proportion? 63, this is the atomic mass of copper. 63.546 grams of copper always combines with 16 grams of oxygen. That is the most important information. It is a definite proportion. So, in the form of atomic ratio, 63.546 is to 16 grams is always present in any compound. In this case, whatever method it is prepared. So, in terms of percentage, if I want to give information, so copper percentage will be 79.9%, whereas oxygen will be 20.1% in terms of percentage. So whatever method. So this explanation, I hope, is very clearly you have idea regarding law of definite proportion. So proportion is the definite, always present. Let me go for the next. Law of multiple proportions. So let me read the statement. This is another important law. When two elements combine to form more than one chemical compound, the different weights of one of the elements, which combines with fixed weight of the other, bear a simple numerical ratio to one another. Let me repeat again. When two elements combine to form more than one chemical compound, the different weights of one of the elements which combines with the fixed weight of the other bear a simple numerical ratio to one another. What is the simple numerical ratio? Means a ratio involving small whole numbers like 1:2, 1:3 or 2:3, etc. So let me explain with a suitable example. You take in this specific example, I have given two compounds here, formation of two compounds. One is carbon monoxide, molecular formula CO. Another is carbon dioxide, molecular formula CO2. Okay, in the first case, carbon monoxide, 12 grams of carbon combines with 16 grams of oxygen. In the second case, carbon dioxide, same 12 grams of carbon combines with 32 grams of oxygen. So among these two, that means when two elements here it is, one is carbon, another is oxygen, two elements. So they are combining to form more than one here, in this case two compound, one is giving CO, another is CO2, so two compounds form. In the both cases, what is happening, carbon is always constant, 12 grams, it is not varying. So only variable in mass is oxygen varies. In the case of carbon monoxide, it is 16 grams. In the case of carbon dioxide, it is 32 grams. So this variation, change of mass, will be in the ratio of 16 gram carbon monoxide, 32 grams in carbon dioxide. That ratio, I can give it as in the simplest ratio, 1:2. So this is the law of multiple proportions. A simple multiple will be there. I go. So this is the an example for law of multiple proportions. Let me explain with one more example. So in this case, second example, here I have taken two elements. One is nitrogen, another is oxygen. So one element is nitrogen, another element is oxygen. So these two elements, they are going to combine to form a number of compounds. The first case I have shown you only two, carbon and oxygen combine to form carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. But in this case, the nitrogen and oxygen combine to produce nearly five compounds. So what are the compounds to form? Nitrous oxide, molecular formula N2O. In this case, 28 grams of nitrogen combines with 16 grams of oxygen. The second compound, nitric oxide, molecular formula N2O2. Here again, 28 grams of nitrogen combines with 32 grams of oxygen. The third compound, dinitrogen trioxide, formula N2O3. Here again, weight of nitrogen is constant again, 28 grams, whereas weight of oxygen it is 48 grams. The fourth compound, dinitrogen tetroxide, molecular formula N2O4, weight of nitrogen again it is constant, 28 grams, whereas weight of oxygen it is 64 grams. And finally, dinitrogen pentoxide, the molecular formula N2O5, that is here weight of nitrogen is again constant, 28 grams, whereas weight of oxygen is 80 grams. So let me explain. So nitrogen and oxygen combine to produce a number of compounds, nitrous oxide, nitric oxide, dinitrogen trioxide, dinitrogen tetroxide, dinitrogen pentoxide. In all the cases, one of the element is constant, mass is constant, that is nitrogen is constant, because in all the cases it is 28 gram. Whereas the mass, the weight of oxygen is varying. The first case 16 grams, second case 32 grams, third case 48 gram, fourth case 64, and fifth case 80. So if you take ratio, so it is a little come now, simplest ratio, 1:2:3:4:5. So this is the specific explanation we can give for law of multiple proportions. So here I have given two examples. One is with the carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, another way, the different oxides of nitrogen. Let me go for the next law. Law of reciprocal proportion or law of chemical equivalence. So this law, different ways, two or three ways we can give the law, because different books are giving different ways. Because in during competitive examination, they will give any one statement and they will give what is the law. So you must know all the three forms. The first one, first form, when two different elements combine separately, with the same mass of the third element, the proportions in which they do so will be same, or same simple multiple of proportions in which they combine with each other. Let me repeat again. when two different elements combine separately with the same mass of the third element, the proportion in which they do so, they combine with each other, will be the same, or will be the same. I will give an example. Will be the same. That's the case one. Will be the same, or same simple multiple proportion, or same simple multiple proportions in which they combine with each other. So this is the statement one. The second statement, again for the same law, second form. If an element A, here we are specifying, if an element A combines with an element B and also another element C, and if B and C combines among themselves, the ratio by weight they do so is simply related to the ratio by which, the ratio by weight in which they combine with a fixed weight of A. So there are three elements A, B and C. So A combines with B, A combines with C. And if B and C happen to combine, and they will reciprocally combine, but what way they are combining with A? That is the second state, second form of statement of law of reciprocal proportion or law of chemical equivalence. Okay, third form, same law, third form, that is law of chemical equivalence. The elements react together in the ratio of their equivalent mass. So based on the equivalent mass, the elements react together. That is, elements react together in the ratio of their equivalent mass. So by these three ways, we can define this law of reciprocal proportions. Because we have no idea, because in the examinations, examiner may give any one of the statement and ask, what is the law? So you must know all the three definitions. Let me explain now with a suitable example. The first case. Here, I am not to explain law of reciprocal proportions. So I have taken a specific example of three compounds. Sodium chloride, sodium hydride and SCl. So here I am assuming A is nothing but sodium, B is nothing but chlorine and C is nothing but hydrogen. So let me explain now. That is, just see here. So A, sodium, it is combined with B, chlorine, and also combined with C, it is hydrogen. If B and C combines, so when A and B combines, the compound is sodium chloride. If A and C combine sodium and hydrogen, the compound is sodium hydride. What is the atomic ratio here? We know atomic mass of sodium is 23. Is to chlorine 34.46. Here I will write approximately 35.5. I will write. So here, the same way here, 23 sodium, and in here it is 1 atomic mass of hydrogen. So here, what will happen now? So 23 grams of sodium combines with 35.5 grams of chlorine in sodium chloride. The same way, 23 grams of sodium combines with 1 gram of hydrogen in the case of sodium hydride. So suppose, if chlorine and hydrogen are going to combine, what way they will combine? So they will combine with what weight it is combined with the constant weight of sodium. So that means here, HCl, let me write now, the product is HCl, that is H is 1 and chlorine is 35.5. So just see here, these two, it is now coming. So this is the proper explanation for this here. Just see here, in this case, so 23 grams of sodium combines with 35.5 grams of chlorine, first case in sodium chloride. In sodium hydride, 23 grams of sodium combines with 1 gram of hydrogen. So now when this hydrogen and chlorine combines, So automatically 1 gram of hydrogen combines with 35.5 grams of chlorine. So that's the values are given in the table. So I will explain very well. So let me take, this is the case, the same ratio. So let me give another example. The ratio will be simple multiples. I will explain another example. So in this case, again I have taken three elements A, B, and C. A is nothing but carbon, B is nothing but sulfur, and C is nothing but chlorine. Okay, now what will happen now in this case? So if you take now, there are three compounds, carbon disulfide one compound, carbon tetrachloride another compound, sulfur monochloride third compound. So in carbon disulfide, 12 grams of carbon combines with 64 grams of sulfur, because atomic weight of sulfur is 32, 2 into 32 is 64. The second case, if carbon tetrachloride, same 12 grams of carbon combines with 142 grams of chlorine. That is, 142 means 35.5 into 4, that is 142. So, it is combining. So now, if sulfur and the chlorine happens to combine, what ratio it will combine? So, in this case, sulfur monochloride, 64 grams of sulfur combines with 71 grams of chlorine. The first case I have explained, they are in the same ratio. But here now, it is not the same ratio. The ratio will be simple, the multiple. Just see here, now to explain this, 142, that is the amount of chlorine, then by 64, that is the amount of sulfur, that is equal to 71, that is in this common sulfur monochloride, 71 divided by 64 against this. So you will get the ratio will be, it will be common. So the ratio will be 2:1. That means, first case, the same ratio. The second case, a simple multiple, that is 2:1 ratio. It will be. So this is law of reciprocal. Reciprocally, they will combine. So this is the example. Let me go for the same definition. Again, third way of explanation is law of chemical equivalence. I will explain now. Law of chemical equivalence. Again, the same law, but we are giving the statement. I will explain that one. In this case, I can give a specific example formation of water. So if you look into these equations, 4 grams of hydrogen, we know atomic mass of hydrogen is 1. So 2 into 1, that is 2 into H2, 2 grams molecular weight, 2 into 2, 4. So 4 grams of hydrogen, 32 grams of oxygen combines to produce 36 grams of water. The left side is again obeying the law of conservation of mass. That it is 36, right side also 36. Okay, let me come for the, what is the law of chemical equivalence? And if you take this, 4 grams of hydrogen and 32 grams of oxygen combined to produce 36 grams of water. Okay. Or the same thing we can write in this form. 2 grams of hydrogen and 16 grams will combine oxygen to produce 18 grams of water. Or in terms of equivalent mass, I can same thing, I can speak, that is 1:2. That is, 1 gram of hydrogen will combine with 8 grams of oxygen. 8 is nothing but equal mass of oxygen. The corresponding 1 is nothing but equal mass of hydrogen. So they will combine in the equivalent form. So they will always, that is the law, we have a law of chemical equivalence. Based on the chemical equivalent, these elements will combine. So whether it is 1:8 or 2:16 or 4:2, that is 32, whatever it may be, it will be the form of the obeying the laws of chemical combination. Law of chemical combination. In this case, law of chemical equivalent is the most important. Let me go for the next. The final one. The law of gaseous volumes or law of combining volumes. So as I have already pointed out, first four laws we have discussed correspond to mass, but this fifth one correspond to volume. So let me read the statement. Whenever gases combine, there is a simple relationship between the volumes of combining gases, and this relationship extends to the volume of the product also, provided if all the volumes of gases are measured under the same condition of temperature and pressure. We can use the term NTP or STP. NTP, normal temperature pressure, or STP, standard temperature pressure. So at NTP, if all the reactant products are gases, this law will obey. So let me explain with a suitable example. In this case, I have given the two examples. One is that is formation of HCl. That is hydrogen one volume, chlorine one volume combines to produce two volumes of HCl. So in terms of volume, we are. The second case, nitrogen again formation of ammonia, one volume of nitrogen combines with three volumes of hydrogen to produce two volumes of ammonia. So they are having, that is during the formation of a compound, always the volumes are correlated with reactants and products, provided if all the reactants and products are in gaseous state at NTP or STP. So this is the fifth law. I hope now you have a clear idea regarding the laws of chemical combination. So whenever this is the most important unit under the basic concept of chemistry, because I have seen, that is, if you go for the 9th book and 10th book, this will be given, but this is the most important, you must know when you study the basic concept of chemistry. I hope you have enjoyed. So thank you very much. See you again. Bye.